opinion. There's no way on earth Ukraine was ever going to be accepted to NATO. Still, the Ukrainian military-industrial complex is not small. Ukraine was one of the largest in the top 10 arms exporters in the world. And the only reason they started to drop out of the top 10 arms exporters is because over the last 3 or 4 years, they started spending so much money building up the Ukrainian military instead of exporting. So the threat to Donbass was real. But the threat to Russia from Ukraine, I don't see, was real. This all could have been handled without a full-scale invasion of Ukraine. Let me back up one step again to the beginning of this rant. Nothing the Russians have done in Ukraine compares what the U.S. did in Iraq and many other places. There's not a moral equivalency here. The war crimes of the United States far surpass Russia or any other country. That doesn't mean what Russia, I think, has done in Ukraine is acceptable, forgivable, or justified. Anyway, that's my rant. Now I'm going to introduce the person who you probably came here to actually listen to, and that's Larry Wilkerson. Larry was the chief of staff for Colin Powell at the State Department and also worked with Powell at the Joint Chiefs. Thanks very much for joining us, Larry.
Thanks for having me, Paul.
All right, your turn, your rant. What do you make of this, the current situation?
The first thing I would observe as a military professional is that Clausewitz said in Book 8, I think, beware of the vividness of transient events. This is a transient event. What does that mean? Well, let's put it in the context of Grant in Virginia when he finally takes over the bulk of the Union forces and he's pursuing Lee relentlessly through Virginia, and he's asleep one night in his tent and an aide runs in all breathless and says, "General, wake up. Lee's on your flank." And Grant thinks for a second, looks at the aide, thanks him, and rolls over and goes back to sleep. That's what a transient event is. And that's what we should be doing, rolling over and going back to sleep, as it were. Because at worst, Putin is probably going to consolidate his hold on the two westernmost oblasts, which he pretty much already owned anyway.
Eastern. And, you said Western. You meant Eastern?
Eastern oblast. And probably, if I were he anyway, militarily I'm speaking now, I would carve out a 50-kilometer wide, maybe corridor down to Odessa, because Odessa is a more important port than any port in Crimea. And that's what Russia's Navy and Russia's military in general is probably salivating over. So why does that affect the security of the United States is a fundamental question. Ukraine was in the Soviet Union for 70 freaking years of the Cold War, and they did not threaten the United States of America, nor did they threaten NATO. Russia did. Moscow did. In fact, the nuclear weapons in Ukraine could not have been shot by anyone in Kyiv or anywhere else in Ukraine. The codes and the firing commands came from Moscow. Ukraine is not a threat now to the United States. So why are we even paying any attention to this? Well, the reason is, as I learned last night, as I watched on Ari Melber's 6 o'clock show on MSNBC and listened to all these pontificators pontificate, the reason is, get this now, we have found the issue that is brought by partisanship back to the Congress of the United States. War, rumors of war, brings bipartisanship back to the Congress of the United States. Are you falling over in shock yet? This is what we're all about today. We are a national security state. We are a military-industrial complex supporting that state. And that's how you bring Americans, sad to say, and their congressional leaders together, is rumors of war and threats of war. And one of the things I wanted to ask all those commentators last night who were advocating for the United States to take maximum action, where's your rifle and bayonet, and when will you be in the front lines, you son of a bitch?
The profit-making of all the military-industrial complexes, and I have to say you're completely right as an American to focus on the American military-industrial complex, which is certainly driving this. And more than driving this, the government in the Ukraine, which was really this lineage of this government really begins in 2014, in a coup more or less orchestrated by the United States, where Biden himself actually had a hand in what happened in the coup and the events afterwards. And when Putin talks about the denazification of Ukraine, American media kind of ridicules him when he says that. But it's actually very true. There are a lot of Nazis in that regime.
It's very true. And the CIA was funneling arms and training and helping those neo-Nazis in Ukraine, just like they have done people like them all over the globe, just like they did in Venezuela, just like they did in Syria, just like they were doing in Iraq. The CIA doesn't care if you're a neo-Nazi. They're going to fund you if you're on their side for a moment or two. That's the way they do things. They were actually working with Al-Qaeda in Syria, working with Al-Qaeda. We actually had a firefight in Syria where the military was shooting at what they thought were Al-Qaeda. They had to cease and desist because they were shooting at the CIA helping Al-Qaeda. That's how dastardly we do things in the world today. And the hypocrisy here, you didn't even touch it, Paul. You didn't even touch it. We have gone to war in Iraq. We have gone to war in Syria. We have gone to war in Libya. We have stayed in Afghanistan well beyond our writ. We tried to overthrow Maduro in Venezuela and Hugo Chavez before him. We have had an embargo for 60 years now on Cuba. We violate international law at our will, and it's almost a daily thing now. So if you want to look at some hypocrites, the hypocrites live in Washington.
No doubt. But I do want to say and ask, it seems to me the real issue here was Donbass, the eastern region of Ukraine, which is primarily populated by Russian-speaking people, which, as far as we know, want to be independent of the Ukrainian, Western Ukrainian state, which is very much an extension of U.S. power and
I think you're right about most of them in that Western, easternmost oblast. I think it's a toss-up in the other oblast, but it's a majority of Russian speakers and Russian affinity, people with Russian affinity. And were Putin to say, as I just said, if this truly is a transient event we shouldn't pay much attention to, if he's going to do what he said he's going to do and just solidify his control there and then stop, then we've got a whole different situation. We need to spin out whatever comes out of that into talks on more important things, things that are serious threats, like nuclear weapons, like the climate crisis. We need to start talking about some very serious issues in this world that only Russia, especially with regard to nuclear weapons, because she's the largest holder of nuclear weapons in the world outside of us, about 8,000 to 9,000 apiece now. China, for example, has 300 or 400. No one comes close to Russia, and no one comes close to us. And this is a real existential threat we're looking at. This new lease on life that nuclear weapons have, largely because we've destroyed the ABM treaty, the INF treaty, the Open Skies treaty. You name the treaty that was good for nuclear arms control, and we've destroyed it. We almost destroyed under Trump, New START. Thank God we didn't do that one. We didn't go all the way. We still have that. And thank God Putin was willing to do it. Those are the serious issues that really threaten American security. We need to get out of this focus on these transient events and get into the real issues.
But that's not where the money is.
No, you're right. You're right. You got to keep rumors of war and war in order to keep Lockheed Martin, Grumman, Boeing, United Technologies, all these people feasting on the monstrous cash that comes from war. You know, I look back on Halliburton and my two real close experiences in Iraq and Afghanistan. Halliburton made $44 billion off Iraq and Afghanistan. I think Pfizer only made $26 billion off its COVID vaccine.
There's no good players in this situation. Number one, creator of the Ukraine crisis is the United States. Most recently, the 2014 coup. But also, the United States could have taken NATO off the table, and yep. so could the rest of Europe, because the whole thing's ridiculous anyway, because everybody knows they will never get consensus in NATO for the inclusion of Ukraine.
Well, think about this, Paul. You've got a good point there, but think about this. There are 30 nations now. But think about this. You go out across the Mississippi toward the west, go up into Minnesota, go down into Texas, come back into Alabama and Mississippi, and ask people where these countries are, and they can't find them on a map. And then you tell them, do you realize you're signed up for nuclear war for Montenegro? Do you know where Montenegro is? You know what? Montenegro is probably the biggest automobile theft center in the world. Okay? None of these countries should have gotten into NATO strictly based on the requirements to be a NATO member. But we sort of massaged those. The corruption is so high. The crime is so high. They shouldn't have gotten in. But these countries are now part of Article 5. An attack on one is an attack on all. If someone were to attack Montenegro, we would have to risk nuclear war for that country. What American is going to sign up to that? Now, people say to me, and they have a point, oh, who's going to attack Montenegro? Who's going to attack Ukraine? Who's going to attack Georgia? You know, my president went to Tbilisi and with Saakashvili by his side, the young Georgian president at the time, declared that Georgia would be a member of NATO. Putin took two oblasts there, too. Don't blame him a bit from his perspective. That's how stupid we are. That's how strategically inept we are. We have made Putin politically, domestically. We've given him the poll ratings to stay in power. And we've given him the mistakes, big mistakes, which he can exploit, even though he's playing with two aces and we have a ham with seven aces in it. We just don't know how to play him.